بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم. We begin with our second lecture on the topic ergot alkaloids. Last time we covered the introduction to ergot alkaloids and their classification. We also discussed their mechanism of action, including their actions on the different receptors and the actions on different tissues, including the uterine smooth muscle, the GIT, and the actions on CNS. So a brief recap of that lecture with some questions. The first question, all the following are peptide ergot alkaloids except. Now we classify the ergot alkaloids into two groups, the peptide ergot alkaloids and the amine ergot alkaloids. So here the answer is D. Ergometrine is an amine ergot alkaloid. All the others are peptide ergot alkaloids, including the dopamine agonists like bromocriptine, cabergoline, and pergolide. And the two ergots, dihydroergotamine and ergotamine. We also mentioned that there are several differences between ergotamine and ergometrine. These are not the same. We will be tabulating the differences between these two drugs. We also mentioned that ergometrine is also known as ergonovine. The next question, all the following statements are correct except. This learning objective is based upon the mechanism of action of the ergot alkaloids and especially their actions on the tissues and receptors. So the first statement, LSD, lysergic acid diethylamide, it is an agonist at dopamine and 5-HT receptors. This statement is correct, and this is the reason why it causes hallucinations. And as we know, the dopamine and serotonin theory of psychosis. So then the next statement, ergotamine is an alpha and 5-HT receptor partial agonist. This is also correct. Unlike ergometrine, which is more of a full agonist at these receptors. Option C, ergometrine is the most effective uterine smooth muscle causes the most effective uterine smooth muscle contraction. This statement is also correct. Statement B, bromocriptine is a dopamine agonist. This is also correct. We mentioned these dopamine agonists like pergolide, cabergoline. And then the last item, pergolide, is a prolactin agonist. This statement is not correct. Pergolide is a dopamine agonist, and these dopamine agonists are prolactin antagonists. So the answer here should be prolactin antagonist, not agonist. As we have mentioned several times, the inverse relation between dopamine and prolactin. Drugs that increase dopaminergic activity will cause a decrease in the levels of prolactin, while drugs that cause decrease in dopaminergic activity, like the antipsychotics, they may cause increased prolactin secretion, resulting in hyperprolactinemia. So here the answer is E, pergolide is not a prolactin agonist. The next question, all of the following are actions of different ergot alkaloids except. Now we did mention the actions of the different ergot alkaloids. Anti-PARP insulin affects, this is a dominant action of the dopamine agonist like bromocriptine. They are D2 receptor agonists and they are used for the treatment of Parkinsonism. They restore the balance between dopamine and acetylcholine and so by enhancing the dopaminergic activity. Option C, nausea and vomiting. Yes, many of these ergot alkaloids produce prominent nausea and vomiting by stimulating the serotonergic receptors in the GIT as well as in the CNS. And then option D, many of these ergot alkaloids, especially ergotamine and ergometrine, are powerful vasoconstrictors, hence useful in migraine. And then option E, epinephrine reversal. Some of these may also cause epinephrine reversal, Bale's phenomena of vasomotor reversal phenomena of Bale. And as we mentioned, Bale in action, he used a preparation of ergot alkaloids in this experiment, in which he observed the conversion of a biphasic response to epinephrine into a uniphasic response by the administration of the ergot alkaloids. This shows that it does have some alpha blocking activity. So the learning objectives of this second lecture on ergot alkaloids, number one, describe uses of ergot alkaloids. Second, tabulate differences between ergotamine and ergometrine. Number three, describe adverse effects of ergot alkaloids. Number four, describe signs, symptoms, and treatment of ergotism. And last of all, enlist contraindications of ergot alkaloids. So the first objective, uses of ergot alkaloids, they are mentioned here. Acute migraine, we have covered this in detail in the lecture on migraine, as mentioned, they are used for acute migraine, not for prophylaxis. They are considered as second line after the triptans because of the several advantages of the triptans over ergotamine, including faster relief, a larger, higher bioavailability, less adverse effects like vasoconstriction and less vomiting, nausea and vomiting. Then the next use is for the management of postpartum hemorrhage. And ergometrine is preferred for this use. As we mentioned, it causes powerful uterine contractions, which help in reducing the bleeding after delivery. It is one of the drugs used for this purpose. However, other drugs like oxytocin may be preferred. However, in conditions where oxytocin cannot be given, then we may give ergometrine. Next use, postpartum heart failure, we will be discussing later on. Then diagnosis of Behring angina, ergonovine is used for postpartum heart failure. Tablet between both of these will be discussed, as will also be Alzheimer's disease, or some transfusion, dihydro or GoTalk series. Then some specific uses of the ergot alkaloid, the dopamine agonists, so bromocriptine being the prototype, the other D2 receptor and agonists like cabergoline and pergoline have similar uses. So number one, as we have mentioned many times, they are useful in the treatment of Parkinsonism by their dopamine agonist activity. One of the major aims in the treatment of Parkinsonism is to either increase dopaminergic activity or decrease the cholinergic activity to restore the balance. Next, in the treatment of prolactinomas, which is maybe due to a tumor of the pituitary gland, so resulting in increased secretion of prolactin. As we mentioned, drugs that increase dopaminergic activity cause a decreased secretion of prolactin. So by this action, these dopamine agonists are useful in many conditions of hyperprolactinemia. So number three is also the same, suppression. Suppression of hyperprolactinemia due to other causes. Then there may also be bromocriptine and other dopamine treatment of may be also be useful in other cases or other causes. Other effects due to hyperprolactinemia, including infertility. Just like hypothyroidism may cause hidden infertility, it is a cause of hidden infertility. Likewise, hyperprolactinemia may be a cause of hidden infertility. Some couples, they are having infertility for many years, and afterwards, upon intensive test, it is found that the woman is having hyperprolactinemia. And upon administration of bromocriptine, the woman is able to conceive after some months of treatment. Then the next use to suppress physiological lactation in mothers who do not want to breastfeed. However, this is not recommended. Again, it is due to the suppression of the lactation secretion. You can see the uses number 2, 3, 4, and 5 all have to do with decreasing prolactin levels, and also use number 6. Postpartum breast involvement. This is a problem in some women after delivery. The breast become overfilled, is engorged with milk, and it becomes difficult for the milk letdown or milk secretion, difficult for the baby to breastfeed. So, in that case, in some of these cases, if other measures are not useful, like using the breast pump or other measure, then we need bromocriptine for this purpose. Then number 7, some cases of acromegaly may be relieved by these dopamine agonists. Treatment of serotonin syndrome, this was discussed in our lecture on serotonin antagonists. And if there is excess serotonin in the blood, this may be caused by increased administration of serotonergic drugs given together, like MAOIs and SSRIs, or SSRIs with triptans, etc. We have discussed symptoms of hyperthermic syndrome, producing hyperthermia and muscle rigidity and other features. Treatment is with bromocriptine at D2 receptor agonist. Besides the symptomatic treatment, you may also give, as mentioned, benzodiazepine, diazepam, and even the centrally acting muscle relaxant, dantrolene. Last of all, the bromocriptine has not been also found to be useful in the treatment of type 2 diabetes mellitus. The exact mechanism is not known. However, it is not having that much efficacy. It only decreases the HbA1c levels by 0.5%. Then the treatment of prolactinoma, a specific mention here, objectives are to reduce the secretion of prolactin to normal levels, to restore normal pituitary gland function, and to reduce the size of the pituitary tumor, and to eliminate any signs or symptoms from tumor pressure, such as headaches or visual problems, to treat accompanying problems like infertility, and to improve the quality of life. We have mentioned the rationale and that dopamine D2 receptor agonist, they cause hypoprolactinemia. Next, we have two questions. Number one, name the drug of choice for treatment of variant angina. This is from our chapter of anti-angina drugs from CBS Pharmacology, drugs used for angina. We did mention that variant angina is one type of angina, also known as vasospastic angina, in which there is vasospasm of the coronary blood vessels. It may be unknown idiopathic cause, and may be due to an underlying atherosclerotic process. So if you remember, the calcium channel blockers are the drugs of choice for the treatment of variant angina. The nitrates may also be used. However, the beta blockers are contraindicated, as they would worsen the condition by decreasing the vasodilation of the coronary blood vessels by the blockage of beta 2 receptors in the coronary blood vessels. Next question, and this drug used for treatment of Alzheimer's disease. This was discussed also in ANS pharmacology. If you remember, the indirectly acting cholinomimetics like rivastigmine, galantamine, they are used for Alzheimer's, the treatment of Alzheimer's disease. So the first related use, miscellaneous uses of polyphenols, we mentioned, we enlisted this use at the beginning. Diagnosis of variant angina, not treatment, but diagnosis. So if you want to ascertain whether a patient has a variant angina, we may give ergonovine, which will produce prompt vasoconstriction during the coronary angiography, and it will give a diagnosis of variant angina. However, this is a very risky procedure, and one should be ready for any complications that may occur, including vasodilator therapy and other management of ischemic heart disease, unstable angina, and even NYMA. Next, use of ergot alkaloids. We mentioned Alzheimer's disease. So dihydroergotoxin has been promoted for the treatment of Alzheimer's in the Russia. The exact mechanism has not been clear. Next use in the treatment of postpartum, peripartum heart failure. Some women after delivery, they develop heart failure. It may be due to the prolactin surge that occurs around the end of the pregnancy. So due to breakdown products of prolactin. And cabergoline has been seen to be effective in this condition. So another use of dopamine agonist based upon its ability to decrease the levels of prolactin. Going on to the next learning objective, the differences between ergotamine and ergometrine. Well, the first difference is that ergometrine has two names, the other name is ergosterone. And then the difference in the action on receptors, ergotamine is a partial agonist at alpha and 5-HT receptors, while ergometrine is an agonist at both alpha and 5-HT serotonin receptors. Next, actions on the uterus. Ergometrine causes much more marked contraction of the smooth muscle at the uterus, while ergotamine less marked contraction. Actions on blood vessels. Ergotamine is a more powerful vasoconstrictor. Ergometrine is a less powerful vasoconstrictor. Main use is in the treatment of migraine for ergotamine, and for ergometrine, its main use is for the treatment of postpartum hemorrhage. We mentioned ergometrine may also be used in the diagnosis of variant angina. We mentioned it does not cause much. It causes less vasoconstriction than ergotamine. This is mentioned here, more vasospasm, less vasospasm has adverse effects. And then we go on to the adverse effects of ergot alkaloids. GIT, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea is secreted by many ergot alkaloids due to their stimulation of the serotonin and serotonin receptors in the GIT and in the CNS, including the vomiting center. Vascular effects for adverse effects, many of the adverse effects are extension of the actions. So alpha blocking activity mostly masked by their powerful vasoconstrictor effect. However, partial hypertension initially may occur. More serious is prolonged vasospasm, especially with overdose. And overdose may result in gangrene even. So much vasospasm that gangrene may occur. And one has to be very cautious about this, as it may lead ultimately to amputation of a limb. And even bowel infarction may occur. Bromocriptine produces erythromelalgia. The picture is shown here. This is a picture showing erythromelalgia. One can see the paleness followed by the redness. The redness is due to the hyperemia, which is seen after some partial the vasodilation, but it is mostly to see all the paleness due to the severe vasospasm. This is a typical picture of erythromelalgia. It is also caused by other conditions. One of them is by the drug bromocriptine. Treatment is with sodium nitroprusside or nitroglycerin when nitrovasodilators are useful. Alpha blockers and other vasodilators are not that effective. Then in the CNS, they especially NFB produce hallucinations and wellness. We mentioned NFB, it's stimulant actions on the dopaminergic and serotonergic receptors, which produce psychosis. Meatballs and dry may also cause CNS stimulation and hallucination like energy. However, methysal guided is now almost obsolete because it causes a more serious adverse effect, which is retroperitoneal fibrosis and pulmonary fibrosis. We have mentioned that other drugs like amiodarone and neomycin also cause pulmonary fibrosis. Then we go on to the ergot alkaloid toxicity, which is known as ergotism. It is known historically as St. Anthony's Fire, and named by the Christians after they noticed these symptoms in some people who somehow took excess amounts of the ergot alkaloids. What was seen and what are the symptoms? Hallucinations, dementia, convulsions, these are all produced by excess activity produced by the ergot alkaloids. We mentioned the cause of hallucinations. Extreme vasospastic pain and even gangrene, this has also been mentioned due to the vasoconstrictive action of the ergots. And so severe uterine stimulation that it may lead to abortion in the pregnant women. The treatment again of the ergotism or St. Petty's trial is with sodium nitroprusside or nitroglycerin, the nitrovasodilators. Last of all, the last learning objective, the contraindications of ergot alkaloids from peripheral vascular diseases, Raynaud's disease, intermittent medication, Raynaud's syndrome, Raynaud's phenomenon, because of their severe vasospastic effects. Are also not to be given in angina due to the vasoconstriction and increase the preload and especially the offload. And then caution and even should not be given in pregnancy and also in especially when it should be used for migraine because of the uterine stimulant action of many ergot alkaloids, including alkotamine, which is used in acute migraine, but should be given cautiously or avoided in pregnancy. So with this, we end with our second lecture on the ergot alkaloids. Today, we have gone through some revision of the previous lecture. Then we have gone through the many uses of the ergot alkaloids, and especially their uses in decreasing the levels of prolactin. So conditions like prolactinoma or other causes of hyperprolactinemia, and then infertility, which may be due to hyperprolactinemia. We also mentioned the use in migraine and the use in the diagnosis of the parent angina, the use in Alzheimer's disease, and then last of all, the use in postpartum hemorrhage and postpartum heart failure. For postpartum hemorrhage, we are using ergometrine, and for postpartum heart failure, we are using carbapenem, again caused by excessive prolactin levels. Then we also terminated the differences between ergotamine and ergometrine, including the difference in actions on receptors, difference in the actions on the mucus, difference in uses, difference in adverse effects. Let me describe the different adverse effects, and the prominent ones were the psychotomimetic effects, and the most serious one is the vasospasm, which may be so severe, especially in high doses, to cause gangrene and the need for amputation of the limbs. It may also cause bowel infarction. And nausea, vomiting, we mentioned, is also seen with these drugs. Last of all, we have come to this last slide, that is enlisting of the contraindications in peripheral vascular diseases, in angina, and in pancreas. So with this, we end with our topics for this week. If you have any questions, you can contact me anytime. Thank you very much.